I think everyone's just in the same boat. It's where they used to look and turn their noses at people before. I think they're now looking at those people in a different light because they are one of those people. We are one of all those people that we thought we'd never be.
Paul Redfern is another one of those people. In a matter of weeks, he's gone from being flat out with work to having no income at all.
I'm a violin teacher, so I teach from home and teach from a school as well. And also I'm a celebrant, so I do funeral and wedding celebrancy. And obviously some pretty strong restrictions on that at the moment.
And just to see that all unravel in the space of 2 weeks, it's pretty full on.
Yeah, it is.
The Redferns were already down to one income while Megan is on maternity leave.
OK, ready? Are you going to go down? 3.
Now they're both relying on welfare payments from the government for the first time in their lives. And even with that help, it can still be a struggle to pay the bills.
We got rid of one of our cars. We have frozen our health insurance for the time being. I'm currently trying to negotiate something with our bank around our home loan as well to try to reduce the payments there.
Before the coronavirus hit, around 700,000 Aussies were receiving unemployment benefits. Economists predict that could jump to 1.7 million as the jobless rate skyrockets.
You have to keep on keeping on. You're not going to cry in front of my three-year-old, am I?
Lisa Treadjet lost her marketing job last month. 3 days later, hubby Jason was stood down from his job as a chef.
It's horrific. We live in the inner west of Sydney, so it's a dual income situation. We were making ends meet, but now we don't have any ends to meet.
Like thousands of Aussies, the couple joined the line at Centrelink to sign up for unemployment benefits.
I never pictured myself going and joining the dole queue. There is a stigma that you can do better than that. And that's really hard to shake.
Centrelink's already been in touch with Lisa to make sure she's looking for work.
When she first called, I was quite surprised and I think I teared up. It's horrific. Absolutely, I'm looking for a job. I wish I still had my job. I want to be employed. I don't want to be a drain on the system.
There's a sort of a sense of shame or a feeling in your gut of discomfort about having to go on welfare because, you know, Australian value about paying your own way runs very deep. But I think it's super important at the moment that people reframe the way they're thinking about it. We're very, very lucky that we've got that support there.
But with no end in sight for this global pandemic, it could be months before new jobs are on the table.
It's a stressful situation. We're trying to keep our heads up emotionally, so it's a whirlwind, and I think looking to a future where we're going to be doing a lot more of this is also pretty grim.
Be kind to yourself. It's a tough time. Maybe take up a mindfulness or a meditation exercise. If you wake up in the middle of the night, write down your worries, put them on a piece of paper and say, listen, I'm going to deal with that in the morning. Keep your social connectedness. Get into a new routine so that we'll see you through mentally healthy for the next few months.
You can't live your day-to-day life thinking about what's going to happen in 3 months' time. You sort of have to use a cliche, live in the moment a little bit more and try to enjoy watching Bluey and, you know, try to enjoy just the time we get to spend with each other.
I mean, surely you don't have to try to enjoy watching Bluey.
No,
I mean,
no.
Yeah.
It's one of the
perks.
That little girl's going to be an awesome violinist with the attention she's getting, absolutely, the one-on-one training. You hear about people who retire and then lose their sense of identity. You can imagine how fundamental that would be for people.
I've got so many friends like that and I'm having conversations with. And we have conversations with some that are still employed and they say it's by fluke that we've still got jobs and someone else doesn't. There's no rhyme or reason to it, but yet you've got people that have never, ever experienced anything like this, navigating a world they don't even really understand.
Right, so here's the question, I reckon, for long term, right? I reckon in this country we've looked down at people on welfare for a long time. We talk about dole bludgers constantly.
Doubt about
that.
No doubt.
We have government programs that are trying to punish them. We talk about how much money we've saved by taking them off welfare, all that sort of stuff. Does this change long-term the way we view these people? Or do the people who find themselves in this position say, I'm different because I was a victim of a pandemic, they're on welfare because they've failed in some way?
Like,
do we go back or do we
start? But perhaps as you move through it and see how hard it is to access, how hard it is to go through the process, how you feel when you're trying, maybe over time, I don't know, pricey. Do you think it'll change attitudes?
I think it'll absolutely change attitudes. I mean, I've known people in the recent past who've struggled to find work and they've gone out and driven Uber instead of going to the Centrelink office because of that stigma. And I think that stigma hopefully now will largely be removed. I'm praying anyway. I think a lot of things through this period are going to change radically, and that might be one of them.
Yeah, I hope it is one of them. Anyway, I suppose we'll see.